As many of you know, or some of you know, Senator Tucker and I were responsible, which mainly means that Joey and Candace helped out arrange the meeting. I have to apologize on behalf of the House. We ended up, we've got a caucus at 1 o'clock, and I'm going to actually have to go down there dealing with a piece of legislation. So I apologize to our guests that it has not worked out for us in the House the way we thought it would. But I appreciate this, and of course this is being streamed, and I think the Locke Foundation, who had an event, I believe y'all had an event in Charlotte today, and moving around, and of course we talked about it on the floor, Freedom in the 50 States. And it is a pleasure to introduce for this presentation, and then I think they'll be willing to dodge some questions after their presentation, as you may have them. Very pleased to have the folks here that are in attendance and that are listening over the internet. Two authors that we have with us in Freedom in the 50 States are Will Ruger, who is Vice President of Policy and Research at the Charles Koch Institute and Charles Koch Foundation. Ruger is author of the biography of Milton Freeman, and that's pretty wonderful task there, and co-author of The State of Texas Government Politics and Policy. His work has been published in the International Studies Quarterly, State Politics and Policy Quarterly, Armed Forces and Society, and other outlets. Ruger earned an AB from the College of William and Mary and a PhD in politics from Brandeis University. He's a veteran of Afghanistan, so thank you, sir, also for your service there to freedom and freedom around the world. Jason Sorens, who's a very young-looking man over here, but wisdom beyond his years. Jason is a lecturer in the Department of Government at Dartmouth College. His primary research interests include fiscal federalism, public policy and federal systems, secessionism, ethics, politics. His work has been published in International Studies Quarterly, Comparative Political Studies, Journal of Peace Research, State Politics, Policy Quarterly, and other academic journals. And his book, Secessionism, Identity, Interest, and Strategy, was published by McNeil Queens University Press in 2012. Sorens received an AB in economics and philosophy with honors from Washington and Lee University. It's a great place to visit up there in Lexington. And his PhD in political science from Yale University, which their distinction is that's where my brother works, so up there. But it's a great honor for us to have you visiting in North Carolina and to share the insights from your research. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, thank you all for coming, senators. If there's any House members, thank you all and staff. Really appreciate you coming out to hear what we have to say. I think it's probably best to start with asking, what is this thing called the Freedom Index? And if you haven't seen a copy of it, here's a physical copy. I think John Samples from the Cato Institute would be happy to give you a copy if you need one. But we'll talk a lot about this study, and then we'll have Q&A so we can kind of have a conversation. Because one of the things that Jason and I would say, first of all, is we have all humility about this. We look at 50 states. The people in North Carolina are more expert on North Carolina than we are. But we hope we could provide a kind of comprehensive overview of the status of freedom around the country, and then allow us to have a conversation about how North Carolina relates to other states and kind of compare those public policies. So what is the Freedom Index? Well, the Freedom Index is the most comprehensive study and ranking of freedom in the 50 states that's available. It's the first to examine not just economic freedom, but also personal freedom. So we look at basically three areas. Within the economic policy realm, two of them, fiscal policy and regulatory policy. And then personal freedom, or what we might call freedom from paternalism. This is the fourth edition of the study, so we've been doing this for a while. We do it every 2 years, and we've been talking about the next edition, which would hit in 2018. And this is a nice evolution. We started relatively small, and now we're up to, you know, like you see, a real thick book here with hopefully a lot of useful data. And it includes all kinds of information, statistical findings, and attempts to look at how does freedom affect some of the things that we care about, like economic growth. So one of the things we do here is we want to say that, look, freedom is valuable for its own sake. But it's also valuable because it impacts, like I just said, a lot of things we care about, like economic growth and whether businesses are moving into a state or out of a state, whether citizens from other states are coming to your state, or whether your citizens are pushed away from that state for a variety of reasons, some of which may be policy oriented. Now, I guess with some humility, we say this is useful for legislators, but you can tell us if it's useful. But we think it could be useful because you can see how your states stand relative to other states. And you can look at our data and our rankings to look at ways in which you might be able to improve, particularly because, as Justice Brandeis talked about, states are laboratories of democracy. They're venues in which you can experiment with things. And maybe if you look and see what other states are doing, maybe that might be helpful to you. When I used to live in Texas before I moved to Washington, and one of the things I used to tell my friends in Texas is, you might not know this, but Vermont, right? You know, people have conceptions about what Vermont's like. It's a deep blue state, home of Bernie Sanders. That's a place that actually has more free gun rules, right? More free gun rights than in Texas, and that surprised people. And that was helpful for them to think about, like, wow, if Vermont can do that, why can't Texas, right? Because Texas considers itself first in freedom. And I know you guys would like North Carolina to be first in freedom. So maybe there's something we could learn from looking at that comparative lens. Citizens use it to hold you guys all accountable, to make sure that you're doing your job as you see it. And as they see it, they can compare what they would like compared to what the legislatures give them. So that could be helpful. Same thing for other actors, reporters, and also just people that are interested in moving their businesses or moving their families from one state to another. So that's why we did this. And another thing is that, you know, what's interesting about our federal system is that even though federalism has been on the decline over the last, 200 something years, but really, especially over the last, 80 years, even though federalism has been in decline, there's still a lot of wide discretion that state governments have, and you know this, and you know the responsibilities you have for the citizens of North Carolina. Some examples of this that we've seen around the country in which real innovative state actions have occurred are things like criminal justice and policing reform, where states like New Mexico, Nebraska, New Hampshire, Maryland have really reformed the civil asset forfeiture laws in their states. And have really been the leaders. And in many ways, the states are where the action is, because there's a lot of gridlock in Washington. That's not news. And even with the Congress and the president now being in the hands of one party, it's still very difficult to move legislation and move things forward in Washington. And so states are really a place where you can experiment, you can do new things, and really push forward to make your states better places. And we've seen that with criminal justice reform in a lot of areas. Same thing with fiscal policy. North Carolina itself has done a good job, and Jason will talk more about that in the presentation about how North Carolina has improved there. It's not something that you guys should be rewarded or recognized for that improvement. You think about education policies. Nevada has been a leader in this area with their ESA program. And so that's an example where there's a laboratory of democracy happening there, and other states are trying to look at that as well. And then even things like regulatory reform. I mean, it's hard to imagine that states like Michigan, Indiana, and Wisconsin have reformed their labor laws, in particular have become right-to-work states. So again, I don't think I need to tell you guys about the fact that states matter, but I think it's important to highlight how important a job that I think all of us recognize that state legislators have. Another big reason why we study states is because you guys compete with each other. You know, North Carolina has gained in population a lot over the last decades, and that's been really good in adding to your tax base and adding to the kind of human capital you have here in the state. And a lot of that is because in many states, people are attracted to freedom. And again, even controlling for climate, as Jason will talk about, that's been a big deal. So how do we define freedom? what we would say is that freedom is a moral concept, and we define it in a very traditional American way, something that would ring true, I think, all the way back to the founders of our country. Essentially, what we say is that individuals are free when they're allowed to dispose of their lives, liberty, and property as they see fit, consistent with the equal right of others to enjoy those things. This is what's called the law of equal freedom. And that includes, freedom from unjust private and public interference, right? If someone's committing violence against you, a private citizen, right, you're being assaulted, that's a restriction on your freedom. But it's also a restriction on your freedom when there are public policies that aren't consistent with that definition I just gave you. Now, in our study, we're just focused on public policies. We're not looking at the efficiency of the public safety system in the states. But we want to recognize that those are both two sides of that freedom coin. Another thing that's probably worth noting, and again, these are two contentious issues, and we have good reasons for not including them, but we don't include abortion or the death penalty. It's not because we don't have our own positions on whether those relate to freedom, but because there are different competing arguments within a kind of freedom-oriented approach on those. So I'll give the example of abortion, right? So we could code for abortion pro-choice or pro-life or anywhere in between, but the fact is that the view of whether that ought to be part of freedom depends upon when you think life begins. And we're not going to take a position in this book on when life begins because in social science we say endogenous. It's not, we can't explain when life begins with our theory of freedom here. That's something that's a religious or a theological or a philosophical or a personal thing. And so what we've done is we've actually left it out of the index, but we've provided different abortion policy regimes that one could have and then looked at the data for that in our appendix. So it's not part of our main rankings, but if you go to the appendix in the book, you could see, based on your view of abortion, what it would look like. So if you're pro-life, we could show you an index of what it would look like, including abortion as pro-life, and then two other types of right, a pro-choice and then a kind of in-between. Because a lot of people have asked us in prior editions, could you at least tell us what it would look like if you included it? So we've tried to do that. Now, I want to give you an aside here, which I think is especially important given that in many cases, conservatives and liberals both think that their version of morality should be ensconced in the law. And what we're trying to say here is that we're just looking at freedom. We're looking at how public policies affect people's freedom. We're not making an argument about whether it's wise that they might use that freedom. In other words, think about something like alcohol freedom, right? So people can buy alcohol. We're not taking a position on whether it's wise to drink or whether it's wise to drink a little or a lot. What we're saying is that in looking at a freedom index, we'd want to capture whether people are allowed to do that. And we're not making a comment upon whether it's wise and how people use that ability to do so. Because we think, and this is in some separate work we do on the relationship between virtue and freedom, that there are better or worse ways in which one can use your freedom, but this book is only about whether you're free or not. And there's an old tradition, particularly in the conservative movement, of saying that in order to be virtuous, one has to be allowed to be vicious, right? In order to be someone who is moderate and temperate in their alcohol, one has to be actually free to consume it. But that's a whole different argument. But we did want to state this because sometimes people say, well, are you condoning, drinking raw milk or, drinking alcohol or gambling? No, we're not condoning any of that. We're just saying that people ought to be free to pursue those things or not. But we're just capturing whether they are. So that gets us to the issue of our data. And this is a very data-heavy study. When we give talks, we try to, kind of not get into too much of the weeds about our methodology. We'll talk a little bit about that. But just to give you a kind of top-level overview, we measured freedom from a lot of different data points over the last, essentially, 17 years. So 2000, 2006, 8, 10, 12, and 14. The last data available, because this is a data-heavy project, you have to get it from a lot of sources. The last data we have is available at the end of 2014. Now, we don't cherry pick a few policies that we think are important. we capture 230 different top line variables. So even if you said, I disagree with Ruger and Sorens on that little thing, and that would change the rankings, that's really not the case in most instances, because we're capturing so much of what happens at the state level, like 230 variables, from state and local tax burdens, to occupational licensing, to educational choice, to raw milk sales even. So it's pretty wide variety of policies. And the fiscal, regulatory, and personal dimensions are all weighted approximately one-third, one-third, one-third. Again, I'm not going to get too much into the weeds, but we don't have a subjective ranking. It's not like we say, well, we think gambling is worth 5% of freedom, and we think, you know, raw milk sales is worth 0.1%, and tax policy is worth 80%, right? That's not what we're doing here. What we did is we tried to be objective as possible and to look at how actually the different policies affect people whose freedom is impacted by those types of regulations or laws. Okay, so what we did is we look at how, or we try to use a kind of dollar estimate based on public policy studies that represents a kind of financial, psychological, and welfare benefit of what is called a standardized shift in the variable in a pro-freedom direction. That's kind of a more sophisticated version of saying we're looking at the cost to people who lose that ability to be free in that particular area. So here's what the rankings look like, which a lot of people love to dig into, and you're more than happy to. You'll see here that North Carolina in fiscal policy, which includes state taxation, local taxation, government employment, government subsidies, and government debt, and you can see the percentages there that they make up of the entire index, that North Carolina ranks number 17. So above average, okay? But our top states are New Hampshire, and then your neighbor Tennessee, South Dakota, Florida, and Oklahoma. Number 50 is New York. Now, that shouldn't be surprising to many of you, and this will be a theme of today's presentation. In terms of regulatory policy, and again, this includes everything from land use to healthcare policy, all the way to labor markets, occupational licensing, to cable and telecom deregulation. And here, again, you see North Carolina is about in the middle on that, with places like Idaho and Indiana, Wyoming, Kansas, and Iowa. And again, New York performs quite poorly at number 50. When you add those two together, we kind of have an economic freedom index within our overall freedom index, and you'll see that North Carolina, again, right about the middle there. Now, to me, that's not a mark of shame. That's something where there's a lot of room for improvement here, right? And North Carolina has been doing better, particularly in the fiscal policy realm, and so it will be moving up in the rankings in the next edition, almost certainly. And that's, I think, a great thing and a great testament to what's been happening here. But as you can see, New York, again, does quite poorly. But Tennessee, again, is one of the more economically free. And that's a little bit dangerous in some senses for North Carolina, because you could worry about losing citizens or businesses to a neighboring state if that doesn't improve. Then we talk about personal freedom, and again, a lot of this is criminal justice reform, but also things like gun rights, educational freedom, gambling, all the way down to travel freedom, campaign finance. So here, North Carolina performs quite well, particularly to other southern states, and that's a real advantage for North Carolina, particularly in terms of attracting a lot of kind of high value-added citizens and businesses who might be looking at a state that has some of the features that we see here. So in terms of overall freedom, we have Maryland, New Jersey, Hawaii, California, and not surprisingly, New York in the bottom five. Okay. Then in terms of the most free states, you have Alaska at number 5, North Carolina, number 19, South Dakota, number 4, Indiana, number 3, Oklahoma, number 2, and then the number one state in terms of freedom, and it's not there because Jason lives there. Well, we just look at the data, and man, it falls out the way it does. And in some cases, you're like, oh, you know, if New Hampshire shows up, that might be a bad thing. They'll think Jason's biased, but it wasn't that way in the last rankings. You know, we just call it as we see it. But New Hampshire was number one. So the live free or die state is living relatively free. Now, Jason's going to come up and talk about some of the consequences of freedom as we've defined it and as we've ranked it. So take it away, Jason.
Thanks, Will. So what I'm going to talk about is some of the trends that we see over time and some of the relationships between state policies and desired outcomes, like economic outcomes. Here, very briefly, I just want to point out that we can see some of the evolution of different states in terms of their rankings. So here, higher rankings are closer to you know, that's more freedom, lower down here, less freedom. You see New York is well below the other states. You see also Tennessee, for instance, declining a bit over time, while Oklahoma is a state that gained a lot over time. State average overall freedom has declined over time. This is a little bit misleading, though, because it takes into account the effect of the federal health insurance law that kicks in here, which obviously caused all the states to converge on a health insurance policy that we had previously coded as pretty not free. And so if you actually take health insurance out, state overall freedom has increased a bit since 2006. There's a kind of trend of increase. One of the things we did new in this edition is we looked at what we call cronyism, maybe a slightly loaded term, but what we wanted to capture with this is policies that seem to intended to benefit particular segments of the economy. So business subsidies, we also look at restrictions on entry, so things that make it more difficult for new businesses to start. We look at minimum markup laws. There are literally laws that many states have that require you to keep your prices high. And we consider these to be sort of cronyist laws that are intended to benefit specific businesses. And you'll see here that North Carolina actually doesn't do so well in this particular sub-index. And we'll talk about that more in a little bit. We do find a relationship here between the number of lobbyists in a state and its cronyism. As the number of lobbyists per legislator goes up, freedom from cronyism declines. In other words, you become more cronyist. And so one of the reasons maybe that some of these states up here are less cronyist might be that they have very large legislatures or very few lobbyists. And we don't know which is cause and which is effect. Is it the cronyism that attracts the lobbyists? Is the lobbyists that create the cronyism? But there is an interesting relationship here. These graphs might be a little bit harder to see on these screens, but here we've looked at public ideology and economic freedom at different time periods. And so on the x-axis, you have basically how left of center a state is. That's Democratic and Green presidential vote shares. And we see a kind of curvilinear relationship. Extremely conservative states, in both of the years we look at here, are not that much freer on economic policy than moderate states. But what we do see is it's the more deep blue states that tend to see big declines in economic freedom. Do Americans value freedom? We didn't know what answer we would find to this question when we first studied it, but we wanted to look at how freedom in 1 year statistically correlates to migration into a state in subsequent years. And what we find is that Americans do, in fact, vote for freedom, and they vote for, it looks like, all elements of freedom, fiscal, regulatory, and personal. Each of these is statistically correlated with net in-migration from other states. In other words, people are moving from less free states to freer states. And this is occurring even when we control for climate, which is another big driver of migration, amenities, crime rates, cost of living, age distribution of the population, and an estimate of capital per worker, sort of an estimate of how rich a state is. Here you can see simple scatter plots, not controlling for anything, showing how overall freedom relates to migration. On the left, you have, this is pre-financial crisis. On the right, you have post-financial crisis. And you see a similar strong positive relationship that states that have higher freedom have higher subsequent net immigration rates. You do see some outliers that make some sense. Arizona and Nevada pre-financial crisis were attracting lots and lots of people. That's not a surprise given their climates. And then you see that North Dakota has been attracting a lot of people because of its oil boom. I believe that South Carolina up here is also attracting lots of people lately. We also look at how freedom relates to economic growth. And so here, what we're trying to explain is the growth rate of personal income. And Adam Smith famously said that little else is requisite to carry a state to the highest degree of opulence from the lowest barbarism, but peace, easy taxes, and a tolerable administration of justice, all the rest being brought about by the natural course of things. So he just basically wanted to test this. Peace, easy taxes, and a tolerable administration of justice. Does that correlate with economic growth, opulence? And we find that it does. We don't find this with personal freedom, which we don't expect to find. Personal freedom attracts people, doesn't seem to boost the economy. But economic freedom is positively associated with cost of living adjusted personal income growth. And that's controlling for all sorts of other things. And it also happens when we separate the sample into pre-Great Recession and post-Great Recession. The result is particularly strong for regulatory policy, and that's also something that we would expect. We would not expect low taxes to necessarily make an economy more productive. It might attract taxpayers. They might like that. But regulatory policy might actually make an economy more productive, right? That might actually help businesses become more efficient, become more dynamic and innovative. So what I'd like to do now in conclusion is to look at how North Carolina fits in to some of these policies. And you can see in the written testimony, you can find more detail. We look at how specifically we might expect North Carolina's economy to change with some of these policy changes. So what is North Carolina doing well? We note that fiscal policy has improved since the end of 2010. We see a decline in state and local tax burdens, a decline in government employment as a percentage of total employment. North Carolina is one of the Sun Belt states that have pretty light zoning regulations, and everyone from Paul Krugman on the left to people like Ed Glazer on the right, economists are pretty universally supportive of this kind of regime because it allows people to move in, allows new houses to be built, and allows people to move to opportunity. And some places like Massachusetts and California have regulated people out of those housing markets. Labor law is pretty flexible in North Carolina, no surprise there. Beyond right to work and no minimum wage, I would also mention that workers' compensation rules are pretty relaxed, and that also makes it easier for employers to bring on new workers. And criminal justice policies, especially compared to other southern states, North Carolina is doing pretty well there with low incarceration rates, low arrest rates for what we call victimless crimes. And North Carolina for a long time has had no state-level civil asset forfeiture program, so it's not possible for law enforcement to seize your property without convicting you of a crime. We have also seen that in recent years, in 2014, school choice improved significantly. Okay, so what could North Carolina do better? Well, government employment is still higher than the average state, so that might be an area where the state could stand to trim a little. North Carolina relies heavily on public hospitals. Other states have a generally private hospital sector. Of course, you also have state liquor stores. Occupational freedom is weaker than average. There are more licensing regulations. It's more difficult to move into new professions. We find this especially in the health professions. The civil liability system is still below average, and we measure that a number of different ways, including liability insurance costs for businesses. One of the ways that states tend to improve on this is by limiting punitive damages in tort cases. And finally, even though the state does not have civil asset forfeiture, law enforcement, we find in North Carolina, heavily participates in federal civil asset forfeiture. And so it's kind of an end run around state law and maybe defeats the point of the public policy that North Carolina has enacted. The Department of Justice can simply say, let us take over your cases and we'll split the revenue with you. And so we don't have to follow state rules anymore and can take property from potentially innocent owners. And then finally, where North Carolina, I think, could most stand to improve are on some of these what we consider cronyist regulations. So it's one of the worst states for insurance freedom. Lots of price controls and rating classification limits for automobile and homeowners insurance. If you have not so great a driving record, it might be difficult for you to get private insurance in the open market. North Carolina is one of the largest so-called residual markets in automobile insurance. And that's because of price controls, right? If insurers could charge higher rates to bad drivers, then they'd be willing to offer those policies. Also, prior approval from the state insurance commissioner for life insurance forms. Many states do not require that. There's an anti-price gouging law, which economists of all ideological persuasions tear their hair out about. You know, why would you, in a disaster, want to keep prices low? Allowing prices to rise will actually attract supplies in to help heal from that disaster. There's also a minimum markup law for gasoline. So don't charge too much, or you'll run afoul of the price gouging law. Don't charge too little, or you'll run afoul of the minimum markup law. So our recommendations are as follows, and again, these are just the types of recommendations that we would make based on our data if you wanted to increase freedom. Number one, eliminate the state distilled spirits monopoly and privatize the stores. Number two, trim hospital spending, which we find is higher than the national average. Number three, trim individual income taxes, which are also relatively high. Fourth, eliminate rate regulation of property and casualty insurance, or if you don't eliminate it, maybe move to a somewhat freer regime like use and file, right? So you can start using a new insurance rate and then file with the insurance commissioner. And we find that that reform alone would have raised North Carolina five places on our regulatory freedom index. Abolish punitive damages in tort cases, or if you can't abolish them, maybe limit them. Sunset the certificate of need law for new hospital construction. There's a lot of research on this. Doesn't seem to have any health benefits. If anything, it results in fewer hospital beds available to people and actually higher costs. Seventh, allow nurse practitioner independent practice and prescription authority. Nurse practitioners can certainly do general medicine, allow them to open practices without having to be supervised by physicians. And then finally, limit equitable sharing with the Department of Justice so that state public policy on civil asset forfeiture is actually followed by law enforcement agencies. And with that, we'd like to conclude and open up to all of your questions. Yes.
So New Hampshire was at the top of the list. And when I go to New Hampshire to visit relatives, it seems pretty dead. Can you talk about that a little bit? Are there other factors in play there? I don't see a correlation between being at the top of the list and not that.
Yeah. Well, New Hampshire is more economically active than the other New England states. You can say that for it. And so people have been, it still attracts people on net, so more people move to New Hampshire than move out. New Hampshire was much more of an economic dynamo in the 1990s. And part of what's happened in New Hampshire is the one area where they do badly is actually the zoning regulations. So it is now a high cost of living state. That high cost of living reflects in part that it's a desirable place to live, that people want to live there, but it also reflects the supply restrictions. So New Hampshire could stand to improve it. If we were giving this talk to them, we would tweak them about that for sure. New Hampshire's also hurt by its climate, so people don't like to live in cold places. So again, I think New Hampshire's doing pretty well for where it's located, but it doesn't have a lot of those natural advantages. You might say the same about the Dakotas, right? Small states, but they're actually growing. And if they didn't have relatively high economic freedom, they'd probably be really bad off.
Yeah, so in some ways, it's the states like the Dakotas or colder states like New Hampshire that actually freedom is an advantage. And people in New Hampshire talk about the freedom advantage. Whereas California has so many natural amenities, it's such a beautiful state, the weather's so perfect, that actually they can probably get away with more in terms of harming the economy because people are loath to leave. But you have seen this. And so you saw in California about, I think, what was it, 4.2% of its 2,000 population has left the state. So if it's so perfect, why are people leaving? Whereas a state like New Hampshire has gained population.
Yeah. I just wonder,
work we've done, how that may have changed.
Yeah, you should see increase.
Yeah, that may well change. So these data were as of for the fiscal data, fiscal year 2015, so enacted in 2014. So I imagine these changes have taken place since then, which would, again, as Will mentioned, improve your ranking next time.
Question. Did I hear you say, or was I asleep? One or the other, but did I hear you say that lower taxes had little or nothing to do with business investment?
I don't think Jason said that. Jason had talked about that. I think we're looking at kind of compared to regulatory policy. So regulatory policy had a bigger impact on economic growth in our findings.
Well, let me turn it around.
Sure.
Do lower taxes have a positive or a negative effect on business
climate? I think they do, yes. You want to add anything?
Yeah, I think taxes definitely attract, low taxes definitely attract taxpayers. And to attract...
Yeah, that's what I heard. Taxpayers.
Yeah, right.
Well, sure, but I'm talking about...
Businesses. Wow. That's right. So I think low corporate income taxes attract business investment. But that's a very small share of overall tax burden, right? No, that's true of any...
Anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
I found it significant that New York, California... Maryland, all of the states that went for Hillary, which are tend to be Democratic states, are on the bad side of your survey. Is there a political aspect of the state? It appears.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to get into partisan politics. You know, we're...
We don't do that down here.
But clearly, the states that have enacted more and more regulations on businesses, more and more taxes on individuals and businesses, more and more restrictions on what people can do, those are states that are really harmed in our freedom index. And you could say, like, look, I care about something else other than freedom. And in many cases, that's what people in California and New York say, is we'd rather have rent control than we'd like to have a freer market in apartments. And that has had all kinds of results, many of which have been quite bad. For the people who have rent control apartments, it's great, right? But you don't end up seeing, and even then, it's not actually all that great because the kind of capital stock, if you will, the apartment itself is usually not treated as well as it could be if it were something that were owned or something where the rents could rise. But again, people could have other values than freedom. We're just trying as social scientists to measure freedom. People could make other choices. They could say, well, I just don't care about this. I don't care about freedom. I care about equality, or I care about other things. Well, I can't tell them what they ought to care about. I'd like them to care about freedom. But what we do show is that they will suffer something if they don't care about those things. So economic growth will be a problem. And also people will leave. And I think that's where the kind of proof of the kind of pudding is, if you will, about why freedom matters, is states like, if you look at the out-migration, the number of people who have left states relative to the number of people who have come in, California, Illinois, New York, Massachusetts, these are states where people are voting with their feet and leaving. And again, it's not just because of weather issues, right? California is perfect weather, people are leaving. Illinois has a great city in Chicago, wonderful city. And people are still leaving. And we believe that that's because they've chosen a set of policies that have caused people who do care about freedom, either directly or indirectly, to leave. And those have tended to be a lot of those blue states. Go follow up.
Freedom as those of us on the conservative side of opinion.
I guess what I would say is at least is how we define it. And there are others who would define freedom, you know, differently, and we don't think that's a good definition, but just to be fair to them. Yeah. Sure. Yes.
I'm afraid they're leaving Chicago because they're getting shot. but I think that's the key. We had to understand when you're looking at your rating system, because when you had it, the slides up there, because that is the determination of freedom in your study, which is from y'all. And I mean, looking up there, I saw where you had the tobacco freedom was 1.8%. Mm-hmm. Well, North Carolina, it's like 92%, or used to be. But and that's the thing about we've got to take in regards, because what means more freedom in my district is different than in Cary or in, even in Randolph County just down the road. So that's what, but I was wondering if y'all had something where we could go in or anyone could go in and measure of how their district or how they view their freedom. Like for me, tobacco freedom would be higher, marriage freedom would be the lever. But anyway, it was just, that's where we could tweak those numbers and then we could see where we think we rank of how we our freedom.
Yeah, so if you go to the Freedom in the 50 States, freedominthe50states.org, you could actually create something more like your own rankings. We also provide all of the data. We're transparent. We provide all of the data for anyone, and a lot of researchers aren't that transparent. We just provide it all and say, hey, look, here it is, and if we made any errors, tell us. And that data can be found also at freedominthe50states.org. Now, as far as your claim about freedom, I guess what I would say is that if there are restrictions on people's ability to choose what they want, consistent with the equal rights of others, then they're not free. What I think you're getting at is how do you weight them in any kind of ranking? And so if the citizens in your district, they would rate, you know, gambling relatively low compared to, you know, whether their right to own firearms is restricted, then I think it would be great, because then you can go in and tinker with that. But again, as long as, I think the key is that you apply a kind of consistent definition, because otherwise then it can get into just like freedom equals what I like. So.
And this actually relates to the point about partisanship, because we do find that while state ideology does relate to economic freedom in the ways I described, it doesn't relate to other areas of freedom. So occupational licensing, conservative states, liberal states, equally free. We actually find that liberal states are a little bit better on some of the personal freedom issues. So again, we're not trying to gore anyone's particular ideological ox here, but.
Yes, ma'am.
I think we would agree with all of that. It's just we think maybe that regulatory policy is sort of underrated, and so we're just trying to play that side up. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah, especially in areas that I think affect the least fortunate. I mean, occupational licenses are so pernicious, particularly in people who are trying to kind of move up the ladder of the American dream. So if you think about, and this is a popular example, it's probably overused, is the hair braiders. You know, but just anyone who's really trying to kind of start a new business or compete in a better way with older businesses, and they're harmed by these licensing regimes. I mean, you think about a lot of states, how many hours, for example, you have to fulfill educational requirements, which aren't really as connected to the job as they're claimed. Or simply kind of pure barriers to entry in cases of, like, think about some of the cartels out there. And this is outside of the occupational licensing to a certain extent, but just think about all the regulations that you've seen on Uber and Lyft. And I don't know what kind of policies you have here on the kind of sharing economy, but in Austin, for example, which is allegedly a kind of hip place, they really tried to prevent the ride sharing with Uber, for example, and that's harmful to people's welfare in terms of their ability in many areas to get conveyance easily, but it's also harmful to people who want to use that as a flexible way to earn more money for their families. And again, a lot of these regulations are the ones that affect the least fortunate. And so I think this is a transpartisan issue, to get away from kind of ideology, a transpartisan issue where people could come together and say, like, look, if you're a conservative and you believe in the free market, these are anti-free market. If you're a liberal or a progressive and you say, hey, we need to do things that can help not just the people at the top rung of the ladder, but the people who are trying to get up that ladder. This is something I think you could really make an effort to reach across the aisle for, especially in this age of polarization. And I have to applaud President Obama, for example, with his Council of Economic Advisors, talking about how occupational licenses are a problem. And I think that's something that we can come together. And then to think about transpartisanship, you think about civil asset forfeiture. That's something where people who want to be, quote unquote, right on crime as opposed to wrong, whether you're on the right or the left, we could also come together on that, because that's an issue in which, again, that's something in which states have too often used policing as a mechanism for profit against the property rights of individuals. And we're not talking about criminal asset forfeiture. We're talking about civil, before any adjudication has happened. And again, North Carolina does well on that. But in terms of this federal end run, that's something that we really need to see more effort on. And again, that's also something that has been shared by I think, people of goodwill on both parties. And I really want to highlight those two in particular. But back to your point, yes, certainly regulations that don't make sense at doing what they're attempting to do, but instead are stymieing the economy, those are some things really would be great to look at.
So first off, I was a Cato intern a couple years ago, and I see samples over here was my teacher for constitutional law back in the day. So I work a lot of the appropriation side of the budget. I was wondering if there's any changes you could do on the appropriation side that would boost this freedom index outside of tax cuts or stuff like that.
Yeah, why don't you take that one?
Well, one of the things we do note is that North Carolina still has higher than average public employment. So if there's ways to trim spending in some of those areas where there are lots of government workers, that might allow further tax cuts and also increase freedom. We mentioned state liquor stores, public hospitals as possibly areas where some of those things, again, deferring to your local knowledge, but some of those things may be movable to private ownership, and that would allow less of a budget hit for the state.
And that's why I want to see, does it overall take in local governmental bodies as well? Because like we have one DOT, we don't have county roads, every road is a state road. And that's one reason why some of our departments are very large, because it's one state entity.
Yeah, we are looking state plus local, so we're not penalizing North Carolina for that.
Yeah, because that issue comes up with debt. Like in Texas, people would ask us, yeah, well, state debt isn't that big. And we say, well, no, but government debt is because of the local government debt. And that's been a problem in a lot of states, is that localities have been kind of spending like drunken sailors. And I'm a sailor. I'm in the Navy, so I can say that. But they've been doing that, and that's been a problem. And that's a way that could affect the states, because if localities get over their skis, who are they going to run to, right?
Yeah, I should note that we do have a little advantage in our index for states that are more fiscally decentralized. So if local governments have more more freedom to tax, and the spending that they spend comes from local taxes, that's an advantage in our index, because that For us, that means people have more freedom to choose their local government and their level of public services. So if you were able to cut subsidies from the state to local governments and allow local governments more freedom to raise their own revenue, that would definitely increase the state on the Freedom Index.
Yes, sir. Well, the argument is that they're more they have to be much more responsive, and because if you don't have a one-size-fits-all, it's much easier for people to avoid that based on their preferences. So think about in Hawaii, this is probably surprising, Hawaii has one education district. That means that there's no way to escape that education district without literally going across the Pacific Ocean. And so you can see how that could be pernicious, right, if you don't have that kind of freedom to choose. And again, it's also because it's much easier, the kind of part of the theory is it's much easier if you have that kind of local knowledge to make good, sensible decisions about what works for your community. It's in the same way as we think everything shouldn't go to Washington, right? Washington could set all the tax and spending policy around the country, and that probably wouldn't serve the citizens of North Carolina as well as if it came from here. At least in theory. And that's a kind of I think that kind of founder's vision of federalism and localism.
I see your point, and I agree with what you say, but it's still sort of transferring the power to give or not give freedom closer to where the decision is made. And that's usually a good thing. But still, it sounds like you just
try. Right, but if let's say that all the localities get over their skis and actually spend more than you would in a more centralized system, that will be coded as anti-freedom in our index because of the fact that it's total, you're looking at the kind of total as opposed to kind of the individual pieces. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So you'll still capture it in the index.
Yeah, and one of the things we see in some states is that local governments can be captured by local special interests. Sometimes it's in some states it might be government employees unions, right, that capture local government because they're the only ones who turn out on elections. So there are ways that states can improve local institutions, improve turnout in local elections. You could hold local elections on the same day as state elections. Some states have considered doing that. And that would get some people who aren't special interests actually to the polls and maybe voting on local budgets and things like that.
Any other questions? Any other questions?
I just got a comment. Sure. I've always been usually on the campaign trail, argued that almost any issue, if you think about it, will have got freedom.
Right.
So I really applaud what you guys have done. It certainly validated my thinking on freedom. I mean, it's really all about freedom to spend your money and run your life.
Yeah, and some people have said, well, why do you include that personal freedom aspect? And we say the same thing, is that, look, freedom can't just be about economics. That's an important part of our life, and that's important to our prosperity. But there's all kinds of other aspects of our freedom that are important to having our kind of living our life project as we see fit. And so if that means that you really get a lot of value out of being able to choose where your kids go to school, that's important. If you get a lot of value about going to the gun range and exercising your Second Amendment's rights, that's an important part of your personal freedom. Or if it's other things. I mean, North Carolina, I'm guessing there's a few smokers in this state. The right of people to choose that for themselves. And I'm not a person of smoke. I don't smoke. I'm not a customer of North Carolina tobacco. But I think people ought to be able to make their own decisions about that issue. And the same thing when it comes to property rights. I mean, I'm someone who, even though I don't like smoking, I remember when there were lots of restaurants that had smoking. I didn't like to go to those restaurants. But the fact is that I think it was really important for restaurants to have the ability to do that, because why shouldn't people who like to smoke be able to smoke while they're eating? My mom was a smoker her whole life, and she loved to smoke when she was after she ate or even during the dinner. And that's something to me that's a kind of private property issue. It's a freedom issue. So restaurants should be allowed to say no smoking, and restaurants should be allowed to say we allow smoking, and people can choose. They can, again, part of the theme of our talk probably is you can vote with your feet. And one of the good things about of having a free market is you can vote with your dollars. And I think that's an important part of what it means to be free, is to have the ability to choose those things and to exercise that choice. We don't, but the Cato Institute has an index of human freedom, in which it tries to look at that internationally. So we have 230 plus variables, 50 states. That's, if I do my math correctly, that's over 10,000 data points. Just imagine how hard it would be to do it as robustly at the international level as we do at the state level. So it's a real challenge. But Cato has made an effort, and all of these things are right attempts to get closer to truth. And we wouldn't be good advocates of the kind of Hayekian view that we have limited knowledge, we can't know everything. We're trying to get closer to the truth. Each index we improve. And I think we kind of want to pursue it in some humility there, which is, so again, if you see some flaws in what we're doing, please send us emails, get in contact with the Cato Institute, because we want to improve this study every time. And especially given you guys know more about North Carolina than we do.
So we ranked 34th in cronyism, and your number one suggestion was to reform our alcohol laws. I was wondering if you guys have a weight in your freedom index for a three-tier system and anything related to that.
I don't think the alcohol system was part of our cronyism index. That's more of like things like occupational licensing, certificate of need laws, things like that. And those are things that we can improve on. And that being said, you know, a freer system in terms of distribution of alcohol would be a preference of ours.
Yeah, and I should note those policy recommendations were not in order of priority. They were just random order.
So. Well, we'd be happy if you want to come up and talk to us afterwards. We'll be happy to speak with you and answer any questions. But again, thank you for coming, and thank you for all the folks that hosted us. We know your time is valuable.
Thank you very much.